Good afternoon. Yes, I am Samir Babu from the Department of Education, University of Kerala. Yes, we have a discussion on certain concerns of research as well as statistical reasoning. I find this is one of the significant topics that especially the research scholars and the teaching faculty and even professors, we need a discussions, rigorous discussion all the time regarding the statistical reasoning and different concerns of research. Now, as a beginner in the research field, beginner in the sense I have done my doctoral research, and as a beginner in the guidance of research, I have gone through certain issues that the research scholars have, as well as a requirement of various orientations in order to fix it up, the various concerns of writing PhD or writing research, writing a report and submitting a paper for a publication. Let me give the scene of or the scenario of doctoral dissertation. I mean, in the sense, the situation in our universities concerning the doctoral dissertations. Of course, it is, I'm talking about a product. At the same time, I'm talking about the processes of research. Of course, when we analyze the researches of various research scholars or various theses, it is evident that most of the theses are poor in terms of need and significance, or highlighting the rationale at the start. What I perceived from my limited reading is that we have to have a thorough analysis of the related literature to come up with a clear-cut rationale of the problem. Review, people have a misunderstanding that review of related literature is for simply writing as a chapter to know some of the ideas about the previous aspects of research. But as I perceived, it is one of the significant components of a research process. We have to intensively and rigorously the related literature to come up with a clear-cut problem to research on. So what I suggest is that the need and significance part of your research, we have to rigorously review the research and accordingly we have to write. It should not be simply the state of mind, explaining the state of mind of your research. No, it should be based on the studies carried out in the past, especially the recent past. I mean, till 2020, we will get sometimes 2021 to be published articles are also available online. That is, in press version is available, or it is made available by various journal databases. So we have to rigorously review this. Of course, we know that research is for innovation, and there should be some sort of novelty in research. So research scholars or those who are doing research, they have to rigorously go through various studies and come up with a need and significance of study accordingly. Not simply a casual writing. It is not an analytical writing without any references. Clearly caught the studies, clearly come up with the combinations of studies, just take some of the variables or construct and analyze the studies and mix up the common variables or commonalities of the studies, and then write your significant or very strong need and significance. That is, most of the time I experience that this is not up to the level by the doctoral scholars. So we have to take care of in this. I'm not giving you some sort of suggestions, but this is just like a reminder for all of us. Part of delimitations. How to delimit actually? People know that there is the delimitation term, delimitation and limitation. But research scholars, most of the time, they are not having much conceptual clarity regarding these two terms. If it is delimitation, that for the purpose of sampling, for the purpose of, that is, for practical efficiency or effectiveness of the practical orientation, we just concise or we just limit the study into specific area or specific group. That is actually delimitation. From my reading, I observed that the possible delimitations are, one is area wise delimitation. Suppose my study is entitled that, so for example, academic procrastination of secondary school students of Delhi. I repeat, academic procrastination of secondary school students of Delhi. If I carry out a survey with a significant random sample, what I come across is, it's very difficult to do a random sample out of this population. So what I can do is, I can write something on my something in my delimitation part, that my study is delimited to southern Delhi. So I have to, as per the title, my study is the academic procrastination of secondary schools of Delhi. At the same time, I am going to collect the data from South Delhi only. That is actually the beauty of delimitation. So this way we can write, even though the title shows something, but delimitation in order to materialize the sampling and its effectiveness, we are just delimiting the area, since the large area is not possible to sample properly. Another is variable wise, we can delimit. Variable wise means you cannot say that I have taken only intelligence, I have taken only academic procrastination, there are many other variables, I couldn't take that variables in my study. Not that way. Suppose academic, for example, let me take the multiple intelligences. I am talking about multiple intelligences. So my study, in my study, I have come across that I am talking about mathematics. So I took only spatial and mathematical intelligence, for example. So certain intelligence categories of multiple intelligences I delimited. That is actually the delimitation based on the variables. Don't go for this way. I mean, I don't find a proof of this, like writing, I have taken this variables only. There are many other construction variables associated with this student. So this may be, due to the limitations of time, I couldn't take those variables. No, not that way. Exactly, if you take a variable and it is large enough, or its depth is vast enough, so you just take a specific aspect of the major construct. That is actually the delimitation in terms of variable. Similarly, we can delimit the variables, or delimit in terms of the sample. But it's actually, sometimes people write that my study is delimited to 500 sample. No, this is very wrong. As I perceive, this is wrong. This actually sampling is for, it is a power to the researcher to sample properly. So it is not difficulty. You can write that sometime I have taken only 400 sample due to the time issues, because it comes as a limitation maybe. But if it is a delimitation, we can write as secondary school students is my sample. All the secondary school students of Delhi is my population. But while sampling, I delimited to 9th standard students only. 9th standard only. Because of the convenience, or in order to properly handle the participants, I take, or I delimit to a specific standard or specific class. So this is 7th standard. So what I do is, as per delimitation, I'll go to South Delhi. I will take only some of the aspects of multiple intelligences, and I'll take sample from the population, again restricted to 9th standard students of South Delhi. So this is actually the delimitation. Sometimes this is missing from our dissertations and theses. So this I have to give a clarity. Now, next is statement of the problem. Most of the time, as an evaluator or as a supervisor, we come across that students write statement of the problem, statement of the problem as title of the study. It is not that way. If it is a statement of the problem, we have to clearly write what you are going to do as a part of the research with the title. It is not the mentioning of the simply the title. Title you can write, of course, if required, not necessary in the statement of the problem. But at the same time, you have to clearly mention what you are going to do as a part of your research. That is actually statement of the problem. Now come to another issue. Of course, people are not always commenting upon that. That is hypothesis. But I point out hypothesis. Hypothesizing is one of the significant areas that we have to clearly discuss on. How to discuss hypothesis properly? What are the requirement of hypothesis? Of course, how we hypothesize. This is one of the issue that most of the learners or scholars come across issue. And the type of hypothesis. Generally, as we know, I'm not talking about the different types of hypothesis. Let me tell you some of the hypothesis, that is directional as well as non-directional hypothesis. This is the only possibility of writing hypothesis as your research hypothesis in your study. What is directional hypothesis? Yes, if we are talking about the relationship kind of study, or if we are talking about, especially when we are talking about a quantitative data analysis or quantitative study, this comes into forefront, hypothesis. Okay. If it is a relationship kind of study, what we are doing is we can write three types of hypothesis. One is, for example, I am taking achievement and intelligence as my construct of the study. Psychological construct, I take achievement, academic achievement as well as intelligence. So if I compare academic achievement, or sorry, correlate academic achievement and intelligence of students, I can write three types of hypothesis, three ways of hypothesis. One is, there is a positive relationship between academic achievement and intelligence. There is a negative relationship between academic achievement and intelligence. There is a relationship between academic achievement and intelligence. These are the three ways of writing hypothesis for me. Only three possible ways of writing. Sometimes people write null hypothesis in hypothesis part. It is totally wrong. When you read any significant standard statistical books, you will find out properly that null hypothesis is only mentioned in the section where we test the hypothesis. It is one of the tools of testing the hypothesis. It is one of the steps of testing the hypothesis, that is converting the hypothesis into null form. So what we have to do is go for either directional or non-directional hypothesis. Then again a question, how do I determine whether this is a directional hypothesis or non-directional hypothesis? One is, if it is a directional hypothesis, the direction of the relationship will be very clear. There is a positive relationship, there is a negative relationship. This is known as directional hypothesis. How do we write it? Yes, we write it based on the reviews. For example, you have come across 80 studies that find out the relationship between academic performance and intelligence. Then see a graph or take a graph or summary of the studies. How many studies report positive relationship? How many studies report negative relationship? Based on that, you can decide which is the possible line of relationship. So if it is most of the studies, generally we know that achievement is positively correlated with the intelligence. So mostly it is a proven fact, or it is proven. It is not a fact, it is proven by researchers. So we can also write that there is a positive relationship, but based on the reviews you summarized. Secondly, sometimes if you find out that most of the studies are explaining that, studies show that there is a negative relationship between these two constructs, then go for a negatively relationship based hypothesis. Sometimes confusing. That is, some studies are positive, some studies are negative, some studies says that there is no significant relationship. So you are also confused. So what you can do is, don't go for a directional hypothesis here. Simply go for a hypothesis that is non-directional in nature. Direction is not clear, but you state that there is a relationship between X and Y, not exactly the positive or negative. Okay, you mentioned neither positive relationship nor negative relationship, but you mentioned that there is a relationship between X and Y. Right, this is a form of writing hypothesis, but most of the time students or research scholars confuse in this regard. So we have to give a clarity in this regard all the time. And when null hypothesis comes, because hypothesis is a significant part of a research process, it is required. We need a hypothesis properly, otherwise it is a flop. The study will be flop, because as you know, we read in textbook that it is a support for the researcher to go ahead with the research. So the hypothesis having its own significance. So we can clearly write a hypothesis here. Now comes to the designing of the study. People sometimes, especially the dissertations of psychology and education, people forget or sometimes purposefully avoid writing the design of the study. Actually, there are certain designs and we have to follow specifically in the things. Now, one is survey design. We have a survey design. Inside the survey, we have correlational design, we have factorial design, sometimes we have different kind of qualitative design, sometimes we have factorial design, sometimes we have experimental design. So there are many kinds of designs available. So you have to put your study into a framework that is actually the research design. So you find out that is actually needed. I'm just giving you a picture of the researchers available all over the country. Now, when we are talking about the tools, research measures, it's also significant. So there are many consensus, based on that, there are many arguments based on the development of the tool. People sometimes confuse. But there is this common pattern of scaling or development of the measure. So we have to follow, especially if it is a doctoral dissertation, you have to develop a scale. Suppose you are adopting a scale. If it is adopting, you have to check the reliability and validity, even though it is established by the previous researchers. If it is you are going to develop, you have to strictly follow the parameters or steps of developing a measurement for your research. Now, another concern is that when we talk about or when we read some of the dissertations, always people write the content validity and face validity are substantiated or ensured through supplying the tool to 8 experts or 10 experts. This is actually a wrong notion. We say that, okay, how can you say that you have given? How can we ensure that this is an evidence? If you're giving it, if giving to someone, is it right? Is it an exact product? Where is the product? Actually, in content validity, there is a content validity ratio, CVR. We commonly call it as CVR. So whenever you are writing content validity, don't mention that. It is not suggested to mention the content validity is established by giving to a group of experts. Rather, you just go for calculating the content validity out of the reflections given by the experts. Of course, you must have given to experts, but you have to mention it properly in your report, research dissertation. So how can we write? How many people reported for a statement? How many people opine that this is essential? Difference with the how many, n by 2, how many people you have given to, half of the people you have given to, divided by half of the total experts. Suppose you have given to 10 experts, you got a reply from 8 of them that this is essential, you can retain this statement. So 8 minus n by 2, n is 10, 10 by 2, 5 divided by n by 2. That is the, I'm not going to dictate the equations or so, but we have to make sure that this is properly dealt in your dissertation. Now comes to the scaling. If you go for a scale, better to go for Cronbach alpha, because we know that there are many internal as well as external measures of validity. Sometimes we have to go for Cronbach alpha, that is with in the item coefficient we will get it through Cronbach alpha. Similarly, we will get we can go for a Gutmann reliability, split half reliability. We can go for a split half reliability. Similarly, test retest reliability. If certain similar kind of the scales are available, you can go for a validity of different kinds, various validity forms we have to check, then only it will be proper. Now come to the another significant aspect of the research report. Sometimes we miss is research discussion of the research result. Let me give a space for the statistical analysis. In the second half, I will discuss the statistical reasoning. Now I am talking about the research and related concerns. Of course, statistics is a part. Still, let me put a space for statistics to discuss its reasoning. Now, when we come to the discussion side, it's also another use of network. I don't know, occasionally it happens. Yes, now my concern was comparative study. When we compare one sample with a national average, the mean score of one sample with a national average, we can go for one sample t-test if it is a non-parametric statistics, that is if it fulfills the criteria of parametric statistics. If it is non-parametric statistics, it is one sample sine test. If it is parametric, that is the scientific statistics, it is one sample t-test. Okay, now when we compare two independent samples, that is boys and girls, we have to compare the means. Here we generally go for t-test, that is independent sample t-test, provided that both the variables are, that is the main variable is measured as a metric scale, in metric measurement, right? Similarly, there will be two groups for comparison, two independent groups. So, for example, intelligence of boys and girls. Again, consideration is, we are talking about independent sample t-test and it is parametric test. So, the sample should be bigger. The criteria, that is the data set, should be normally distributed. So, this is the criteria in the case of independent sample t-test. Now, the opposite side of, when if it is not following the normality, if your measurement is not exactly the metric measurement, or your size is not up to the level, not scientifically drawn sample you have, then you can go for U-test, Mann-Whitney U-test. Mann-Whitney U-test is suggested. If your sample is very small, SPSS or any kind of software package, or even though you calculate by hand, manually, you will get a result. But doesn't matter the result. The thing is that the logic behind it, whether it is admissible or not. Statistically, if your sample is very small and the measurement is not exactly the metric measurement, and if the data set is not in a normal distribution, it is not suggested to go for a parametric test of independent sample t-test. Better to go for a U-test. Similarly, we have a paired sample t-test. If two scores of a same category is being, especially in the pre-test and post-test score, if we compare the pre-test and post-test score, we have generally paired sample t-test as a parametric statistics, paired sample t-test. That is one score and the same score of the students or group participants. So we are comparing both the score in order to identify whether the given intervention is effective or not. In such a case, better to go for two sample tests, that is paired sample t-test. In the opposite side, we have Friedman test. Friedman test. Similarly, if you have more than two group for comparison, sometimes in some of the dissertations, it is strange to see that they will compare group 1 and 2, 1 and 3 and 2 and 3. Suppose they have three groups. It is not a logic. There is a statistical calculation, that is F-test or one-way analysis of variance. If you have a one metric variable that is assessed either in interval or ratio scale and you have categories 3 or more than 3, then you have a statistical calculation called one-way analysis of variance. This is also comparison of mean score of a group. You have one mean score and comparing it with the three categories, that is three categories as categorical variable: science, commerce and humanities students, rural, urban and semi-urban students, married, unmarried and separated. This kind of categorization, if you have in your categorical variable and you are taking into account one metric variable, then you can just do this as one of the statistical calculations if you follow all the parameters or most of the parameters essential for calculating a parametric test, that is one-way ANOVA. So one-way ANOVA for calculating or comparing the mean scores of three or more than three groups. Right, now what will be the strategy if it is not parametric, if it is not scientific sample? The remedy is H-test, Kriskal-Wallis H-test. That we have to go for Kriskal-Wallis H-test. Now we have some other test in correlation. This is parametric correlation, product moment correlation. But what are the other non-parametric correlations? Kendall-Stowe is one of the non-parametric correlation. Similar kind of correlation to rank correlation. Rank correlation of Spearman. Spearman's rank correlation. Phi coefficient is there. Biserial correlation. Point biserial correlation. Tetrachoric correlation. Phi coefficient. All these are non-parametric type of correlation. Biserial, point biserial, tetracorrelation, phi coefficient, Kendall-Stowe, rank correlation of Spearman. These are non-parametric correlation. For example, one-way ANOVA, let me give an example. Compare the adjusted mean scores of academic achievement of male and female students when the effect of intelligence is taken as a covariate. We are taking covariate intelligence and comparing the achievement of boys and girls. That is, sex category we have taken as a comparison of intelligence, and now we are, this is not relationship. See, this is comparison. We are talking about comparison here, male and female comparison. You find a similarity here with the partial correlation. That is, comparing the, what was the partial correlation? Relationship between 1 and 2, variable X and Y. For example, in this case, variable achievement and intelligence. Achievement and intelligence will be correlated considering study habit as a covariate. We can do is study habit as a covariate. That is partial correlation. In that case, all the variables are metric variables. But in the case of ANCOVA, the major variable is a metric variable, that we have academic achievement here. Academic achievement is a metric variable. And we are comparing academic achievement of boys and girls, right? Considering intelligence as a covariate, because intelligence, I have to remove the aspect of angle of intelligence. So achievement of male and female students will be compared considering the intelligence as a covariate. This is one-way ANCOVA. See another example. Comparison of mean scores of boys and girls in their achievement, considering intelligence and study habit as covariates. There are two covariates. Still, this is also a one-way ANCOVA. Two covariates we have. What are the two covariates? Study habit as well as intelligence. You are comparing the achievement of male and female or girls and boys, considering study habit and intelligence as covariate. Two covariates you have. Still, this is also a one-way ANCOVA. When it comes as two-way ANCOVA, 2 by 2 factorial ANCOVA, when it comes 2 by 2 ANCOVA, this comes if you take the academic achievement of boys and girls belonging to rural and urban category, for example. That is, locality you are taking, sex category you are taking together as two major categorical variables. Then comparing their achievement together and finding out the interaction effect, considering intelligencer as a covariate. That is, compare the mean achievement scores of boys and girls belonging to rural and urban background, considering intelligence as a covariate. Here, what are the variables? Categorical variables, you have six category and locality of residence. Major variable, you have achievement. Covariate, you have intelligence. That is, there are two categorical variables. That is a cross comparison of two category of gender, that is sex category, boys and girls, two category of locale. This is called as 2 by 2 factorial ANCOVA. 2 by 2 factorial ANCOVA. So this is analysis of covariance. Now we have one more thing I have to explain with you. This is logistic regression. What is logistic regression actually? When we are going for a logistic regression, it is actually when the variable, that is the criterion variable, is nominal. And so let me continue that we were talking about the testings, that is which kind of statistics we can select. Now, let me continue that when we are going with a nominal or ordinal data set, better to go for that kind of test. That is non-parametric statistics. When we are having small sample, sometimes people do a small kind of meaningless. We cannot judge upon the calculation. So better when you just see the data set, whether the data is exactly the normal, more or less similar to the normal curve, then you just go for the data, testing of the data accordingly. So here the decisive factor is the normality. So when size of the sample is small, it is recommended to go for non-parametric test. Now just a comparison of parametric and non-parametric test. Now comparison of parametric and non-parametric test. Okay, let me take correlation kind of thing. Product moment correlation is when we call